Today, the latest weapons, coupled with the fighting skill of the American soldier, stand ready, on the alert all over the world to defend this country, you, the American people, against aggression. This is the big picture. Now, to show you part of the big picture, here is Sergeant Stuart Queen.
The privilege of serving the United States in uniform is no longer limited to men.
The value placed by the Women's Army Corps on meticulous grooming and feminine grace is one of the first lessons learned by the recruit.
There were demands that would require of her perfect physical health and stamina.
I'm sure you've all heard the saying, there's a right way, a wrong way, and the Army way.
Technicians,
plumbers,
carpenters,
electricians,
art illustrators,
statisticians,
air controllers,
security police,
auto mechanics,
fire chiefs. Look up, we look up to in the air.
212 radar contact, turn right heading 150.
With a fog-bound helicopter hanging on your every word, it doesn't matter whether you're a man or a woman. Only that you're
coming
good.
Up slowly.
Be all that you can be.
Thanks for your help.
Roger.
Cause we need you in the Army.
I'm flying in a helicopter right now. Don't second guess yourself.
It's a lot of work, but it's totally worth it.
I would just always see the movies of the military, and I just knew that was me. That's what I wanted to do. That's what I wanted to be. There was a waiting list for the Navy over a year, and I knew I didn't want to wait that long. So I had a friend tell me about the Coast Guard, and I went to the Coast Guard, and they said that they could get me in within a month. So I said, okay, ship me off.
I tried college, and I had a good job at a vineyard in East Texas. I bought my own little house, and the military was something I always wanted to do. I come from a military family. I was always taught that it's every citizen's duty to join the military. If you can, you should. And so I wanted to go ahead and join and start a career.
I joined the Air Force. I was 17 years old. I had a boyfriend that encouraged me to go in. So that's what I did. My mom signed, gave me permission to go.
When I was in high school, I was impressed with the Marines that I had met. There used to be a lieutenant colonel that used to run laps around the track after soccer practice. And he said, you'd be perfect for the Marine Corps because you're really fit and smart. And that's what the Marine Corps needs. The professionalism, the camaraderie, everything about it inspired me.
After I graduated high school, I left for Orlando, Florida, which was the first time I was ever on an airplane in my life. Initially, it was just wanting to go see the world because I'm from a really small town. I had a college scholarship to go play basketball, but I instead opted to go into the military. So that's what I chose to do.
I come from a long line of military lineage. Somebody from every generation on both sides of the family, all the way back to the Revolutionary War, had served in the the armed forces. I chose the Marine Corps because no one in my family had ever done it.
I love putting on a uniform every day and, you know, just getting out there and giving it my all, and it's a very proud feeling.
I would have done boot camp over and over again. It was great, the camaraderie, the discipline, everything it taught you. Who I wanted to be, that's what they taught you there.
Obviously, it was different taking a shower with 80 different people all of a sudden because it was pretty shy. But just a great experience. I was a 4-0 sailor. Every single report done on me was excellent, great. I knew what I needed to do in my job. I was a great team leader.
I really enjoyed the whole challenge of it. I got several different awards and kudos. It was mainly men. I loved that I could blend in and keep up with the guys and, you know, work as hard as they did.
The Naval Academy was challenging. The education was top notch. My senior year, I was selected to be one of the top 30 leadership positions by the company grade officers there.
After basic, I went to Naval Security Group, ADEC, Alaska. I remember getting there, you know, issued a parka, got set up in my room, and then he took me to the bar, which was in our barracks, and sat down at a table where it was me and about 10 other guys. And, you know, kind of felt like a piece of meat on a slab at that point. And I never wanted to turn around and leave so much in my life, but I couldn't.
I met Corey December 17th of 2007. I was on watch when she got to the station, and she kind of just blew me away when she walked in.
Cookies, right? Is this what you ordered? Okay, thank you.
The command told us that she was coming and there were some issues, but none of the crew knew exactly what had happened, and I didn't find out for a long time.
Mommy, where's the heart?
He loved his job, and it's kind of like he gave it up for me.
She loved the Coast Guard more than I did. She wanted to make it a career, but seeing how they treated her, I didn't want to stay in. I did it, and then I did my extra year, and I got out. I couldn't believe what had happened to her and what she'd went through.
I was stationed in Saginaw River, Michigan. I was the only female in my section. I had a supervisor. It got to the place where I'd get calls at 3 o'clock in the morning and he'd be drunk at a bar telling me to come get him. And I'm like, I can't, I'm in bed. And he would then threaten me. I'd walk in from training and he'd be sleeping in my bed. When we went to one of the higher ups, the chain of command, they were all like his drinking buddy, and they told me just because I didn't like somebody, they weren't going to switch me away from this guy. It was in the evening around taps, and he had unlocked the door, and he'd come in, and he had an erection, and he tried to get me to touch him. I took my right hand, and I pushed him in the chest and started to yell for the other guys to kind of hear me, to hey, hey, hey. He hit me across the left side of my face. I remember holding the closet, thinking, what just happened? And my face hurt so bad. And when we went to the command about it, me and the petty officer who saw my face, they let it wait because they didn't want any kind of problems going on. A couple weeks later, I needed the key to do my cleanup. So I knocked on his door, and he said, okay, yeah, come on in here, it's in here. And I said, no, I'm gonna wait out here. And he screamed at me, and he made me come in, and he grabbed my arm.
and he raped me in his birthing area.
Everything came to a complete change the day that I was raped.
I got there in February. By April, I was drugged and raped for the first time.
I had like a cold or pneumonia like symptoms, and so they sent me to get checked out. And while I was waiting to be examined, he came in and he helped himself.
He said he was going to the bathroom, and he came into my room, and that's when he raped me.
The entire time I was screaming and yelling for help and for him to stop. Nobody came to the door, nobody came to help me, came to my rescue or anything.
They made it very, very clear that if I said anything, they were going to kill me. And then of course I didn't have anyone to go talk to because the people that were perpetrating me were the police.
It was my first time ever, and I've had a tough time convincing myself that I'm still a virgin.
If this is happening to me, you know, surely I'm not the only one, in which I found out later going through the claims process that I wasn't.
It's just after 3 a.m. I see shadow of a human head over my body.
Next thing you know, like I wake up and like he's on top of me.
He pushed my legs apart and put himself on top of me and started pulling at my shirt.
And I wake up and that he's on top of me. He's already penetrated me.
I was drugged. I remember the sounds, the smell.
He put his locked and loaded .45 at the base of my skull, engaged the bolt so that I knew there was a round chambered.
All I could do was continue to concentrate on breathing.
He slammed my head against the concrete wall and very forcefully had sex with me.
I just went to my tent, pulled a sleeping bag over my head, and cried myself to sleep.
So within the 2-week period, he raped me 5 times.
When we got tested, I had trich and gonorrhea, and I was pregnant.
He raped me.
In 1991, in congressional testimony, it was estimated that 200,000 women had been sexually assaulted so far in the U.S. military. If you take into account that women don't report because of the extreme retaliation, and that was, you know, more than a decade ago, I would say you could easily double that number, and it's probably somewhere near about 500,000 women have now been sexually assaulted in the U.S. military.
Well, according to the Department of Defense, 3,230 women and men reported assault in the last fiscal year 2009. But they also admit, DOD itself, that 80% of sexual assault survivors do not report. So if you do the math, 16,150 service members were assaulted, which is an extraordinary number.
We're in the cars, Rob. This all was prescribed in the last 3 to 4 months. This is paroxetine, this is Seroquel, citalopram, this is Xanax.
I'm tired of taking all these meds. I just want the VA to fix my jaw.
I was having the most horrible pain in my face. And I went to the dentist because I thought it was my teeth or something was wrong. The doctor came in after the x-rays and asked me if I'd been in a car accident. When he hit me in my face, he dislocated my jaw and it sent both of my discs forward in my face. So I don't have any discs where they should be in my face. They told me I'd probably need a partial bone replacement from where my bone had been laying on my nerves for so long, it's starting to actually disintegrate. I've been on a soft diet for 5 years now. I can't eat the foods that I used to eat. Everything is mashed potatoes, Jell-O. Well, I can go out during the summertime, springtime if it's warm. If it's too cold outside, it's usually just Rob and Shay go outside. When it's really cold, it's like my jaw will just lock up. I just stand, watch from the window, and hear about the stories when they come in.
We are sorry, but due to a large volume of calls and unusually long wait times, counselors are unable to answer your call at this time.
Please stay on the line as calls will be answered in the order received.
50 minutes could save you hundreds on car insurance.
It's a St. Louis holiday tradition.
Stay away for a while now. You gotta feel like a child now.
Hey, this is Stan.
Hi, Stan. I just wanted to check the status of my VA claim.
Still no final decision on it yet.
Okay, it's...
You look like it's about a year old now.
Yes, it is. Okay, it's still pending. Did it say what status it was in?
Well, it looks like they've gathered all the information that they need, but it still hasn't moved to the rating board yet.
Okay.
Thank you for calling in. Have a good day.
You too, thank you. This is the stuff they prescribe me for migraines, even though I don't have migraines. So I was looking online, and there's actually other vets at the age of like 25, and they would actually just die because their body wasn't processing, because the mixture of the Seroquel, the gabapentin, the some kind of anxiety, which was the Xanax, and there was something, an antidepressant. The mixtures of that stuff, which is everything I have here that other vets were taking, and they have died.
Baby girl.
Hey.
I see it.
See it. Yep. Can you see it, babe?
Both my dad and my brother are prior Navy and now Army National Guard, and it's kind of like it follows in the family and follows the footsteps. I was excited and completely just hyped up about going, and all my family was proud of me. My dad is my biggest hero.
I told her, I said, you're going to be taken care of. And I guess that's one of the hard things that I have to accept, because I told her that she would be. It was in February. We got a call.
Once he was done, he rubbed his hand all over my entire body and told me, he said, I own all of this. And I was just absolutely scared, didn't know what to do. I called my dad.
One of the first things she said is, Dad, I blow like a virgin. And I said, what happened? She said, I was raped. And I said, Anna, you're a virgin, because he took something from you that you didn't give. I said, so don't ever think you're not.
My main nerve in my spine was pinched in three places, and my hips were rotated. I could barely walk. I had collapsed due to muscle spasms in my back, because my back was injured during the rape.
My title is Director of Military Plans and Personnel Policy for the Navy. We have specifically trained judge advocates, our Navy lawyers, and our Naval Criminal Investigative Service. Those investigators, they're all specifically trained in sexual assault. Any report of a sexual assault is fully investigated in the United States Navy.
They didn't take care of it. For a year and a half, they were tracking down witnesses. They had all these students there, and they could have locked them down and said, hey, you're on legal hold until I get this statement. And they didn't. Hannah went through three investigators. It was like, okay, I'm giving this case. That's what it sort of felt like. Oh, all right, I'm giving this case. I got to take care of it. Oh, well, this is an E1. I really don't have the time to deal with it.
Females would come up to their commanders or their NCOs and say that they were either sexually assaulted or abused, and I don't think it was taken seriously. I think a lot of times a cursory investigation was done, and they were basically told to just suck it up.
I remember bringing in a young service member who had been brutally raped and bringing her in to see her command and trying to make sure that this young girl was taken care of properly. And this idiot chewed her out for crying, told her to stop crying over spilt milk.
A lot of times the credibility of the witness was called into account, or had the potential victim, had she made claims like this in the past. There was a lot of witch hunting going on.
I was ordered to advise a victim of her rights for false statement when I knew that she wasn't lying. I was asked to bring her in and advise her of her rights like a criminal and interrogate her for false statement, quote unquote, until I got the truth out of her. If a woman makes a rape complaint, there are always people asking what she was doing there, what she was wearing, whether she had a boyfriend or not.
If rape cases came in, they were never given to women. The men always took care of those.
Why is that?
Because we were too sympathetic.
Is that what they said to you?
Mm-hmm. We couldn't see what was really going on because we always took the woman's side.
I was told I should have been a social worker. I had no business being in the police field. There was a lot of resistance there toward the idea that victims should be afforded some kind of sensitivity. It was almost a laughing matter.
We have given specific training and continual training to our NCIS, Navy Criminal Investigative Service, those investigators on how best to respond and to investigate those crimes.
They told me they lost my rape kit and my nurse examiner's report and the pictures from the bruisings on my arm.
They lost these things?
That's what they told me. They told me that they had lost them. And me being me, I decided to do a little digging of my own, and I spoke with NCIS headquarters in Washington, D.C., and they have all the evidence.
So what does this mean?
Because the case is already closed, there's nothing they can do.
What we hear again and again from soldiers who have been raped is that as bad as it was being raped, what was as bad, if not worse, was to receive professional retaliation in their chosen career merely because they were raped.
When you report something, you better be prepared for the repercussions.
If a man gets accused of rape, it's a setup. The woman's lying.
I could choose to report it, but if they found that what I was saying wasn't to be truthful, then that I would be reduced in rank.
You could lose your rate, you could lose rank, you could lose your school if you file a false report. So do you want to file a report?
Even with the rape kit and everything, and the person, my friend, catching him raping me, they still don't believe me.
I reported it two different times to my squad leader, and he told me that there was nothing he can do about it because I didn't have any proof.
They actually did charge me with adultery. I wasn't married, he was.
They took me before my lieutenant commander. He says, "Do you think this is funny?" And I said, "What do you mean?" He's like, "Is this all a joke to you?" I was like, "What do you mean?" And he goes, "You're the third girl to report rape this week. Are you guys like all in cahoots? You think this is a game?"
Danielle McDonald.
Okay. I show that we've got a claim open for a non-service connected disability pension, depression, TMJ, bilateral disc condition, PTSD, nerve damage. I'm showing that that's gone to the rating board in Cleveland.
Okay, and how long does that usually take?
Anywhere from 102 to 139 days.
Really?
And that's just an estimated time frame.
139 days? I mean, that's, like,
I've already been waiting like 14 months. What the fuck is going on up there? Like, what the fuck is going on with the VA? Like, my shit is new and it's 14 months? I bet if we were there in person, they'd have to do something. Are you ready? Stay ready. Do you know where we're going?
Where are we going?
No, to the doctor. Why are we going to the doctor? What hurts on mommy? My face, that's right. You're gonna wanna get on 75 North.
On 75 North?
Yep. This goes everywhere with me. And then this goes everywhere with me. You always have protection with Jesus, but sometimes you need just a little bit more.
I love you.
Good.
Mommy, be out in a minute, all right? Say bye to Mama.
Bye-bye. And doctor's appointments, I come to every one just in case. She gets worked up and she's uneasy around men already, so I have my phone up on me, and she, you know, she already has. I tell her to have a text message or me on speed dial if she needs to get out of there.
Bye.
We'll get you a big surprise.
Come on. How'd it go?
It went good. They ordered a back x-ray instead of a face x-ray, but here's some makeup. They should know what's wrong with me. Like, read my stuff and you'll see that it's my face. It's not my back, it's not my legs, my arms, it's my face.
People who need the proof don't even know what your case is even about.
Like, I don't even know why we wasted the gas money, the trip, anything. It was completely a waste of time. What a good Veterans Day, right?
Yeah, it's a perfect way to spend it.
Yeah. Screw it.
All right, it's around midnight on October 24th, and Corey woke up myself and our baby. She woke up screaming. So it's been happening quite a bit.
Woke you up, but it's fun, right? We're having fun.
Okay, more.
Yeah, let's put more in.
I think Corey almost likes it better because it's quiet and, you know, really no one to run into at midnight.
Because it was an isolated duty station, they were in charge and we were just kind of like cattle. So that was the first time that I was drugged and raped. I was in this room with some of my friends, and I only had like one or two drinks, and I went and laid down. It was like instantly I was not feeling well and came to having a pillow over my head and my friend raping me. And that went on repeatedly. You had to call an operator to get a line off base, so they listened to your phone calls. So they were screened. And I used to call my dad and beg him to get me out of there. He would always ask me, you know, hon, well, what's wrong? And I'm like, I can't tell you what's wrong, because the people that were listening to our phone calls were the same people that could hurt me.
Most sex offenders are hunters. Just like any hunter, they study their prey. They study their movements. They study the behaviors. They study the environment.
You have rapists that prey on other human beings. They stalk them. They wait until the victim is at the most vulnerable point in time to perpetrate their crimes.
A lot of times the victim is somebody that the suspect is very familiar with, and they're very aware of what's going on.
Most sex offenders have this hidden persona that nobody ever sees except for the victim. Therefore, when they're caught, or if somebody reports, people don't tend to believe that because they don't see the typical sex offender.
If it's an officer, it's an officer that has habitually in the past preyed on an enlisted. They would do it once, they'd get away with it. And then they think, wow, this was pretty easy. I'm gonna try it again.
Particularly for a savvy perpetrator to work within a relatively closed system like the military, it becomes a prime target-rich environment for a predator.
When I was discharged, I moved to Seattle, or things got really bad. I started to lose everything. I was homeless. There was addiction. I was selling drugs, packing a gun.
40% of homeless female veterans have been raped while they were serving. They spin into such depression and abuse that they can't hold jobs, they can't hold their lives together, and they end up on the streets.
My partner, Amy, I met her a few years ago. I was going and trying to do some stuff at the gym, and
when I first saw Trina, I was at the gym, and I look over, and it was like the universe was like, there you go. And in my head, I was like, well, there you are. Well, I knew there was something special about her.
Wow.
For sure. When we first started dating, it was hard. The biggest hurdle was not taking PTSD personally. It does get really stressful.
What's that?
A traitor.
Traitor? Oh, like a vendor.
Yeah.
Oh. Not like I'm a traitor, like you bastard traitor, that kind of thing. Okay.
If I've ever lived with anybody, it's just been with that person. So when I moved in, it was like, oh my God. You know, it was Amy.
I'm not just moving in
three
with
boys.
Amy. I'm moving in with an entire family.
I was like, oh my God.
Yeah.
So they were so used to such open space. And with my PTSD, we had some moments.
I'm sort of sad to have never known Trina beforehand.
Yeah.
When she was sort of in her prime. Now she's anxious and sad a lot.
You gonna go protect me, Mitch? Susie, come. Let's go.
Yeah. A lot of times if we're out doing something, Mitch will be like, check it in, like, oh, it's okay, Trina, it's all right. I'm appreciative of it, but it makes me really sad that here's this little 11-year-old boy that's watching out for my well-being. It hurts, I want it to go away. And it doesn't go away.
Move it!
Yes, sir!
I think the men that we attract to the military, we've got the army of one, be all you can be, all those themes that we've had throughout the years, very, very heavily masculine. Masculinity cannot be victimized, because if you're a leader, if you're a masculine person and you're victimized, then you're weak. The problem is that anybody can be a victim of sexual assault.
I joined the service in 1972. The military is a great way of life. I got to see the world. I got educated. I love the military. was 19, and I went to the chow hall alone, and the next thing I know, I was laying on the ground. I was struck from behind, and two guys were holding me down, and one guy was pulling my pants down. And, you know, he was taking care of his business. And, you know, I struggled, and I was being struck and hit and told to shut up or they'd kill me. And I see how it destroyed my life. I mean, I've been married 3 times. Just luckily, I have a wife right now who I've been married to for 25 years.
You start wondering, and you start sort of, you know, either coming up with reasons why things are the way they are. And for a long time, I kept thinking, I don't know, there's something else.
I had never told anybody in over 30 years. I decided to tell my wife. It was the scariest moment in my life. I was going to tell my wife she was going to leave me, and I would be lost without her. I mean, honest to God, I couldn't get up every morning without my wife. You know? And I told her.
I felt horrified, and I felt sad, and I felt angry, and, you know, along the course of the evening, you know, feelings just started to surface that were probably just simmering for a very, very long time.
And she put her arms around me, and we both sat there and sobbed. It was like this great weight had been lifted off of me.
I think it's important to recognize that military sexual trauma is not limited to women. And in fact, when it comes to the absolute numbers, because of the proportion of men in much larger numbers than women, actually the numbers are even greater.
I think one of the last bits of research showed that about 1% of males had been victims of sexual assault within the past year in the military. That equals to about 20,000.
You would get labeled as a buddy fucker. And that's not a nice term to be related to. So it's one of those things that you don't talk about it, or you don't bring to anybody's attention. You just kind of keep to yourself.
It's really, really hard to forget. You know, up until now, I still, they live in my head, you know. I can hear them laugh. I can see their faces. I can see what they're doing to me.
I felt scared. And I was scared to tell my friends, the people that really knew me, the truth about what happened.
The shame, as bad as it is for women, is even worse for men because it's all tied in with homophobia.
The people who are doing the raping are not gay. That's not the problem. They're worried about gays in the military. The gays are not the rapists. They're heterosexual men, for the most part.
This is not an issue of sexual orientation. This is simply an issue of power and violence. Male sexual predators, for the large part, have targeted whoever is there to prey upon, whether that's men or women.
Whenever I see that, you know, there is evidence that another woman has been sexually assaulted, the question I keep asking myself is, when does this ever end?
Breaking news at this hour, the Navy appears to be facing a huge sex scandal. Details are still coming in.
From ABC, this is World News Tonight with Peter Jennings.
Good evening. We're going to begin tonight by putting a human face on the worst case of sexual harassment in the Navy's history at an annual Naval Aviators Convention called the Tailhook Convention. Senior officers have known since 1985 that the convention included the so-called gauntlet, set up for the specific purpose of targeting and sexually molesting women.
I got off the elevator on the third floor. You could see maybe 200 men. It was just a few steps into the hallway before they closed ranks around me. And then it happened very quickly that from both sides and from behind, men came in and started reaching in my shirt. I was getting pushed down to the floor and someone was reaching under my skirt, pulling my underwear off. And, you know, it was about maybe 30 or 40 feet of 200 guys trying to pull my clothes off, like I was a high value target. The next morning, I met with my boss for breakfast, and I said, you know, what happened here? And he said, well, that's what you get for walking down a hallway full of drunk aviators. And I was like, I don't think so.
An investigation was finally begun. But 1,500 interviews later, the Navy's Inspector General reported that his investigators were being stonewalled. A great wall of silence had gone up to protect the guilty.
The U.S. Army today is trying to establish the extent of a new and growing rape and sexual harassment scandal.
It all took place at the Army base at Aberdeen Proving Ground, where 30 women have filed complaints of sexual advances that range from unwanted touching to rape and forcible sodomy.
Aberdeen Proving Ground is a location where the non-commissioned officers were assaulting and raping trainees, and then passing the name of the person they had assaulted to another NCO.
That is unacceptable conduct for soldiers. It's unacceptable to the Army, and we have zero tolerance.
12 years ago, the Tilhook sex scandal shook the U.S. Navy, and now the Air Force faces what may be an even bigger problem.
Rape and other sexual abuse at the Air Force Academy in Colorado Springs.
142 allegations of assault against women had been made in the last decade.
The highest-ranking Air Force generals knew about serious problems of sexual assault at the Academy, yet failed to take action.
We don't intend to sweep this under the rug. We take it very seriously. We're going to address it publicly.
In Congress, outraged senators accused Air Force brass of ignoring assaults on women.
We have a clear pattern of reports of sexual assault where the reaction of the Air Force Academy seems to be to blame the victim.
We are in the process of instituting those changes now.
You're in the process of instituting those changes sure. now.
Obviously, you and I and the Secretary have a fundamental disagreement here.
What needs to be done and should be done as it relates to the problem of sexual assault within the military, women in the military that have had a great deal of difficulty accessing some sense of justice?
I totally share your concerns. We have to have zero tolerance for any kind of sexual assaults in the military.
At a small post in Washington, D.C., Marine pride, history, and tradition live on. Marine Barracks at 8th and I Streets is the oldest post in the Corps, and for 100 years, from the early 1800s, it was Marine Corps headquarters.
Marine Barracks in Washington, D.C. is the most prestigious unit there is in the Marine Corps. This is the unit where the best of the best go. It is the Marine Corps' showcase ceremonial unit. It handles presidents and dignitaries, security at the White House, the silent drill team.
After my deployment to Operation Iraqi Freedom in 2008-2009, my commanding officer recommended me for the Marine Barracks Washington. I was excited. It was the tip of the spear as far as the Marine Corps is concerned.
She would stay at work late, and then she would drive home, and she'd call me, and she'd be on some kind of little high, and she'd talk about how she loved her job. She was this sweet person who was trying really hard. And succeeding.
One of the first things I was told when I checked in was, don't wear any makeup because the Marines will all think that you want to sleep with them. And I thought, that's just ridiculous.
The atmosphere off the bat at Marine Barracks Washington was horrible. People asked me what sexual favors had I performed to get my orders there.
There was a senior officer in my command who, the first time he spoke to me, he said, female Marines here are nothing but objects for the Marines to fuck.
So the minute a female shows up at my work, she's immediately pounced on. All of the new females get talked about, saying that they're having sex, sleeping with so-and-so. Apparently I slept with all these men, and I mean, I didn't.
It got progressively worse and worse. They determined that I welcomed the sexual harassment by wearing my regulation length uniform skirt and running in running shorts. There were several junior female Marines that came up to me crying while I was there, saying that they felt too humiliated to come to work.
One of the duties at Marine Barracks Washington was a ceremonial drill. The evening parades are what you would see on the news, the silent drill platoon, president, everybody goes to those type of things.
After the parades, all the officers are required to stay till midnight and drink in Center House at Marine Barracks Washington. So we're talking about Wednesday night happy hours that start at 3 and end at 2 a.m.
It was a partying and drinking culture. The atmosphere revolved around going out and partying and drinking.
I was ordered to drink. I was ordered to attend the drinking events.
My boss even said that they were mandatory to me. She's like, we do our best work at these events.
We went to various pubs and bars, and the goal was to do a shot at each one, all paid for by the Marine Corps.
You're talking about drinking events where other senior officers are drinking to the point of peeing in their pants, you know, passing out on lawns. This is the norm.
At one bar, I had water, and I was ordered a shot anyways and told I needed to take two shots to make up for that. I left the bar to get a cab. My company commander followed me and said, I need to talk to you about some things. So we walked up the stairs into his office. There was a little bit of a struggle. He tried to kind of make an advance and try to kiss me. I tried to leave and he slammed the door on my arms. I fell on the ground and hit my face on his desk. And the next thing I realized was I had woken up wearing his shorts with all of my clothes off and in tremendous pain. I knew enough about me that something wasn't right and I had felt entirely violated. The colonel at one point said, you know, Lieutenant Helmer, boys, girls, and alcohol just don't mix. We'll never really know what happened inside that office. Only you and the major know, and he's not talking. So at this point, the investigation is closed for lack of evidence, and we've reopened a new investigation against you for conduct unbecoming an officer and public intoxication.
I remember going to the bar. It was an officer that started buying shots for us. After I'd had a couple drinks, that's all I remember. This officer bragged to his fellow officer friends that he had bagged me. I got called up to a major's office and he charged me with fraternization and adultery. He was married, I wasn't, and I was charged with adultery.
I told the battalion XO about the humiliation in the comments. And he said, you know, you should do what a Marine officer should do, and that's to ignore it and move on.
I used to lie awake in bed, you know, wondering what I could do to help her get out.
He said that if I told anybody that he was gonna have his friend Marv from Indiana kill me and throw me in a ditch because that's how they took care of things in Indiana.
She went to war and gave 9 years of her life. And for them to take it and come back and say, yes, they called you a whore. Yes, they called you a slut. Yes, they called you a walking mattress. It's documented over and over and over again. But you deserved it, and when you complained about it, you were welcoming it.
The actions of my seniors, both in the assault and in the ensuing investigations, have really destroyed me.
When your wife doesn't come home to
rummage through the house, searching for the suicide note. To call the police with one hand while you're restraining her from killing herself with the other.
I think the thing that makes me the most angry is not even the rape in itself. It's the commanders that were complicit in covering up everything that happened.
This is an organization that gives commanders an unbelievable amount of power. And I felt it as a lieutenant in Iraq. It's scary. You appoint the prosecution, you appoint the defense, you appoint the investigator, you're in charge of the police force, you're in charge of the community. You own everything. You are a judge, you are a jury, you are executioner.
Most Americans assume that there is access to a system of justice. So that, for example, if you're a civilian and you're raped, you can call the police, and then you have prosecutors, either federal prosecutors, state prosecutors, local prosecutors, that bring the perpetrator to justice. The problem with the military is that instead, they have to go to their chain of command.
Now, in our system of military justice, it is the commander who's responsible to the chain of command for how that investigation proceeds.
I know that there's been numerous times over my career that I regretted that an individual commander had the total say-so over a case. And most of them don't have the training or the education to determine what's appropriate in serious felony criminal investigations.
The problem in the military is the convening authority, who is not legally trained, makes the final decision.
They had a change of command at my old squadron where the guy that raped me was still stationed. He had only been in command for 4 days, and he made the decision over legal to stop the case.
What I saw was commanders, and these are field grade officers, lieutenant colonels, colonels, who have been in 20, 25 years. You know, they're career officers, and they sweep cases under the rug.
The last thing a company commander in the Army wants to do is make the phone call to his or her battalion commander to say, I have had an allegation of a rape in my unit. This is viewed in many cases as a failure to command that will adversely then affect their career.
Sometimes you'd see a guy get 4 or 5 years for selling a minor amount of drugs. Then you'd see a guy get, you know, 2 weeks extra duty for a rape.
The military hides behind this notion that it is really, really hard, almost impossible to prosecute rape.
But when you look at prosecution rates in the 2010 Department of Defense reports, you begin with 2,410 unrestricted reports and 748 restricted. What that means is they've already funneled 748 sexual assault victims into a system that has absolutely no adjudication whatsoever. Then you take the 2410 that have been reported. Of those, they identified 3,223 perpetrators. Now, what happens once you send a perpetrator over to command? Well, the command has just completely unfettered discretion to do whatever it is they want. And what is it that they do do? First off, they drop 910 of them. They just don't do anything. Then of the 1,025 where they actually take some action, do they court-martial them? No. Only half of them, 529, actually got court-martialed. The rest, 256, were subjected to Article 15 punishments, 109 to administrative discharges, and then 131 to, quote, other adverse administrative actions, whatever the heck that means. And then of the convictions where they actually get jail time. When you work your way all the way through the numbers, what you're looking at is that out of 3,223 perpetrators, only 175 end up doing any jail time whatsoever.
I have been in Congress for 7 terms now, and every single term we have had meetings with DOD And they come in and they confirm to us, we're going to be serious. We're going to take care of this. We're going to stop this. Zero tolerance. But the rhetoric is not being turned into the reality of protecting our women and in some cases men in our military.
And they're like, but we have the SARC and SAPRO program. It's like, well, oh, great. What does that do? They can strongly suggest to the military to do something.
As a band of brothers and sisters, it is our personal duty to prevent sexual assault.
They can't order them. They can't enforce it. They don't back it up.
In April of this year, we will debut a social marketing campaign as part of our prevention strategy.
Preventing sexual assault is part of my duty.
So when I saw my buddy's date was drunk, I told him, ask her when she's sober.
It's ludicrous. You know, it's the year 2011, and, you know, we have posters that say, wait until she's sober. I mean, it's remarkable that that's allowed to pass in today's military.
We've implemented training at each and every level of military service. From the moment they enter the service and basic training, they're given that. And our campaign consists of a series of posters that are actually training tools, and each of those posters has a different focus.
You cannot prevent sexual assault with pretty posters, right? Posters do not prevent sexual predators from preying upon women and men in the military. We're talking about people barging into rooms in the middle of the night. No poster's gonna prevent a criminal from barging into your room. These are violent people.
Well, one of the things that we do in our prevention strategy is to focus on bystander intervention. And in that strategy and in that training, we ask for each soldier, sailor, airman, and marine to be aware of what sexual assault is and how to prevent it. SARC is a joke. The things that they say are ignored or they're made fun of.
Turn the other cheek is a thing of the past. Up close and real when they try to harass. When they dare in the dark and the predator persists. Step up in his face, you can tell him this. We stand, we stand, we fight, we fight, intervene.
It might be a video or 20 slides. It's like a lot of military training where it's the once a year check in the box. SAPRO can't fix anything.
You walking back alone?
Yeah, it's just a short walk to my chew.
All right.
And all the money seems to be spent on advertising, which is just rife with victim blaming.
What's your name?
Hey, stop.
Hey, come here, let me talk to you for a sec. I just want to talk to you. Oh, are you okay?
No, there's this guy, he grabbed me.
Why are you by yourself? Where's your buddy?
I didn't think I needed one.
Sexual assault is preventable. Are you doing your part?
And so this notion that, you know, essentially, like, anyone could be a rapist, we all have to be on alert, it misses an opportunity to take real steps towards preventing rape. If they actually had systems of accountability that prosecuted and imprisoned perpetrators, you would get rid of a lot of the rapes right away.
How would you characterize the typical sex offender?
Well, if I look at our data from the Department of Defense, it's young people that are ages 18 to 24, 25.
Would you say that most of them are serial rapists?
I don't have data one way or the other to determine that.
And what percentage of the rapes do you think are caused by serial predators?
I don't have any numbers. I don't know how to. I don't think we collect that type of data.
There's been studies done that people who enter the military are twice as likely to have committed rape as their equivalent population in the civilian world.
I'm not aware of that study. My area of expertise focuses primarily on prevention and victim care.
But wouldn't prevention include focusing on the perpetrators?
I noticed that Dr. Kay Whitley is not in her chair. Is it under your direction that she is not shown for testimony this morning?
Yes, sir.
You directed her not to?
I did.
Do you have an executive privilege to assert?
No, sir.
You've instructed her not to come. What is your reason for doing that?
If you find the department's response and prevention efforts fall short of your expectations, responsibility for that shortfall rests with me.
That's a ridiculous answer. What is it you're trying to hide? We all remember Tailhook and the scandal and how the military tried to cover that up. I don't know who you think elected you to defy the Congress of the United States. We're an independent branch of government.
So for now, Mr. Dominguez, you are dismissed.
Intimacy is definitely affected. He'll go for months without sex. I have to initiate. If I'm comfortable enough, if I'm having a good day, and I think my husband looks hot for the day, I have to initiate. When he comes up and hugs me, sometimes I'll cringe, and I just want him to, you know, like, he'll feel it. And then he gets mad because he didn't, like, why aren't you hugging me back, or whatever.
I still do that. There's a times
where I like him grabbing my hips, and
but
like,
I didn't understand, you know, why, because it's like, I'm your husband, why? And I don't fully understand now.
I see it in my dreams. That's what you don't get. I don't want to talk about stuff, and you know that.
Yeah, well, that's the hard part. I don't know how. I want to help you, but I don't know, you know?
But
I want to.
You can't help me. Like, that's the thing, is you can't. Sometimes I think, if when he has sex with me, is he thinking about, you know, me getting raped? Is he upset? Is he, you know? Because I think about that. It doesn't run through my head. That's why I didn't want to have sex for a while.
What if you were in my spot?
It would suck so bad.
Wouldn't you want
I'm not saying I don't appreciate you. It made me cry. Maybe this is why I don't express it to you, Rob, because it does upset me. Like when we almost split up because of stuff, and I feel like I'm responsible for it. I don't know what I'd do if I lost Rob. I don't. I'd be so lost. He's like my only supporter. Like my own blood.
I have interviewed women in the civilian world, and rape is a very, very traumatizing thing to have happen. But I've never seen trauma like I've seen from women who are veterans who have suffered military sexual trauma.
I cannot remember how many times a young female Marine that had been raped or sexually assaulted had told me that she looked at these guys as her brother, or the suspect as her brother.
It's akin to what happens in a family with incest. Because, you know, in the military, when we're functioning at our best in a cohesive unit with brothers and sisters, you know, the band of brothers and sisters, I mean, we are family. When that bond of trust is violated, the wound penetrates to the very most inner part of one's soul, one's psyche.
I have this folder that I keep. I have all my boot camp letters in it from my mom and my sister and people. And I was just going through some of this stuff, and I'm like, what's this? You know? And I open it up, and I'm like, oh my God, my suicide letter. Mom, I'm sorry for the grief that you must feel. Just because I'm gone physically doesn't mean I won't be there spiritually. I truly feel that God will take me without question, even though I took my own life. I've had the most broken thoughts, dreams, and physical pain to remind me of the horrific acts upon me that happened while on duty. A mother, brother, sister, and husband should never live with knowing the horrible acts upon me. Find peace in knowing that the body left behind doesn't consume my soul. I am free now, and I'm not afraid. Ready to soar, Corey Danielle.
I took a whole bottle of pills and woke up, strangely enough. I'm not sure why. At that point in my life, I just wanted it to be over. And I think I was 20, 21. And then within the next year, I tried again.
I went out into the garage, which is separate from the house, and I turned the car on. I was gonna sit in the car and asphyxiate myself. And we have this little poodle, Blondie. She went out a little doggy door and she's scratching and howling at the door. I said, shut up, God damn it, you're gonna wake my wife up. So I got out, shut the car off, and I thought for a minute, I'll just take her in the garage with me. And then I says, why would you kill a dog? That's stupid. And then it dawned on me, well, why would you kill yourself?
I thought of it so many times and in so many ways. I thought about, at one point in time, hanging myself from the flagpole with a sign on me and saying exactly what happened to make him feel bad.
I was gonna overdose on pain medication and sleeping medication and just hope that I'd fall asleep and my body would just shut down or do something. When I went to the doctor, I had been feeling sick and dizzy and nauseated, and they took my urine and they told me that I was pregnant. It was like, you know, there's a life in there, you know? And maybe her life will be better than mine, and I gotta make sure that. So, she's very special.
Sometimes it takes a different kind of action to cause change to come. And sometimes that's a lawsuit.
I grew up on military bases. My dad was career Army. When I was a child, when we answered the phone, we used to have to say, Colonel Burke's quarters. And because of that, I have an understanding of the level of control that the military exercises that perhaps most in civilian life don't have. The Ferris Doctrine is a judicial doctrine that was developed by the Supreme Court that says if you're in the military, you cannot sue for something that happens to you that's incident to your military service. If military doctors amputate the wrong limb, you're out of luck. You cannot sue for that harm that's been done to you. So we filed a lawsuit in federal court on behalf of 16 men and women seeking to bring former Secretary Rumsfeld and Secretary Gates to justice.
I heard about the lawsuit and decided to become a part of it because I never wanted another woman to go through what I went through. I've been so sick, like just sick to my stomach. And I think right now I'm just kind of like, just get there. I'm like numbing myself just to get there. And then I know when I get there, it should, I don't know.
The lawsuit alleges that they have overseen a system that has deprived the rape survivors of their constitutional rights. Specifically, we allege that they deprive them of their substantive due process, procedural due process, equal protection, and First Amendment rights.
It made me sick to see everybody's stories, how they kind of closely tie together. Everybody's story somehow it's consistent, like what the military does to people like us.
All the things that they put in place are all pretty much intended to help women deal with being raped better. That's what they're about.
I joined the military halfway through my senior year of high school, wanting to serve my country and do new things and challenge myself in a different way. I was in the Army about 7 or 8 years before anything ever happened to me. I was raped by another CID agent who was senior to me. I was contacted by an agent with Fort Riley CID who said they were investigating the suspect as a serial rapist who had raped several military law enforcement women, and I thought there was no way that, you know, he wouldn't be convicted.
If I have a difficult time with anything, it's about the fact that I had an almost 10-year career, which I was very invested in, and I gave that up to report a sex offender who was not even put to justice or put on the registry, and he's probably doing the same thing right now.
I had one female lieutenant pull me aside and tell me that, you know,
She had heard about my case and she thought she could talk to me as one female Marine to another. And she told me, well, what he did was capitalize on an opportunity that you presented him. That's not the same thing as rape, and you need to know that. Like a month after it happened, they made me go on a hike with him. And I tried having everybody advocate for me to not make me go because I just couldn't deal with seeing him. So their solution to that was just to put him right in front of me so I could see him the whole time. So that way I could know where he was and know that he wasn't able to do anything because he was right in front of me. And I remember thinking the entire time we were up on the hills up in Camp Pendleton, like if only it was steeper, I would have jumped.
There's no way out of it. I mean, if you think about it, the only way out of it is like suicide or AWOL.
It's true.
So those are your only two options, suicide, AWOL, or deal with it.
Right now, I'm just barely appreciating, learning how to appreciate being a woman again. That's 11 years. And I'm trying to have fun with it, not forcing myself to have fun. I'm trying really hard not to cry, but it just pisses me off. You know, and watching you girls having to go through what it makes me want to explode.
Being here and like knowing that me wanting to commit suicide, I'm not alone. Me being hit and raped, I'm not alone. Everything, the way that they treated me, the way that they made me feel, I'm not alone. And we have all you guys with all your knowledge and everything. You guys are gonna stand right up, you know? It's awesome. It's awesome, that's what I'm saying.
I think the women who are coming forward in this lawsuit are very courageous because they're putting their names out there for criticism. They're putting their names out there to go down in history as they were the ones who got raped. And that isn't anything you want to go through life with.
Today, I stand in solidarity with the courageous women and men who have served in our nation's armed forces. The inspirational plaintiffs you see before you are a small handful of the tens of thousands of troops and veterans who have been sexually brutalized by their fellow service members while defending our nation. It is time to finally acknowledge that the military judicial system is broken when it comes to these cases.
My name is Corey Choka, and in my case, my command was unwilling to help me. I went for help several times with other petty officers, and I was denied help, even with other men saying, please get her away from him. And it was still allowed.
My name is Sarah Albertson. People were telling me, don't go to the public. Don't let this get out because it'll make the military look bad.
I really feel like my social responsibility to speak out about this issue, especially considering my investigative experience and the fact that the military justice system allows so many offenders to escape justice.
Starting to play with her toys, you know, together,
yeah.
You know?
Imaginative and play so and neat stuff, yeah.
But it's all the stuff that you teach them, if you notice, like when they play.
Yeah.
Like, you know, it's really cool.
Yeah. I miss my baby.
I do too. Thank you for having us.
Sure. Thanks for being willing to fill me in a little bit on some of the experiences.
My name is Regina Vasquez, and I served honorably in the United States Marine Corps for 4 years.
My name is Corey Choka, and I served in the United States Coast Guard. I was harassed and sexually assaulted.
I was administratively discharged with no benefits after 9.5 years of service.
Women should not bear that burden. That is not part of what we should have to be doing to do our jobs.
We're talking about criminal activity. We're talking about a vicious attack that is criminal. It is an assault.
Almost none of the cases made to court-martial. And out of the ones that do, almost none of them result in convictions.
It seems to me in all the times that I've looked at these things that the command is the one who has so much discretion.
I think our advocates should actually be civilians, not ones that work for in the military. I think we should have actual units, civilian units.
It absolutely tears in my inside to think that this has been going on for as long as it's been going on, and we've never addressed it.
All people in the military must know if you are a perpetrator of sexual assault against someone else in the military,
woe be to you, you're gonna be held accountable.
As a CID agent, I found it tremendously frustrating when I would demonstrate that an offender had committed an offense and taking it to a commander and having a commander be the deciding authority. You know, I don't think commanders are capable of making an objective decision. I do not think it should be in their hands.
So you would suggest taking the discretion away from them?
Yes, absolutely.
Congresswoman Davis and I are both on the Armed Services Committee.
There are a number of issues that you've raised that makes, you know, me want to go back and particularly take another look.
On an emotional and individual basis, what happens after a crime like that has been committed? It's a very difficult thing to go through. And don't think I don't know. I know.
The fact that you're willing to tell me your stories firsthand makes it much easier for us to go back and to say, you know, these are policies that we have to change. It's a big deal what you're doing.
You rarely find people like you who will stand up for us, and just thank you so much for everything that you do.
Very nice to meet you all.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you again for your service.
Oh, thanks for your time.
Mr. Speaker, last year the military received over 3,000 reports of sexual assault involving other members in the service. This week, 17 veterans are saying that the military ignored their cases of sexual assault while they were on active duty.
Today, I'm going to talk about Seaman Corey Choka, who served in the Coast Guard from August 2005 to June 2007. She now suffers from PTSD and an abnormal EEG due to nerve damage in her face. Choka later told the press, "It's like they didn't care. It wasn't important. I wasn't important."
So we're eating at Bob Evans and we overhear a girl talking about getting ready to go into the military. So I go over there and try to talk to her.
Has anybody told you what to watch for or anything?
My boyfriend's in the Navy.
So he knows how tough it is for women, yeah?
Yeah, he's been in for a couple of months now.
So how does he feel about you joining? Like, isn't he scared that the men will do something?
He's a little scared, but he knows I can take care of myself, so he's...
Oh, I thought so too, so be careful.
Yeah.
I definitely let her know that maybe she should reconsider college and getting a degree, and it'll save her some of that trouble. I wish someone would have told me that.
You try to take care, okay?
Thank you.
Can still back
Thank
out,
you
huh?
Very much.
You can be a civilian worker. You
I'm
know
not,
that.
I'm not signed yet, but
okay. Well, just be
Thank
careful.
You.
People always ask me, was it worth it going in? The idea of it is honorable. Serving your country is great. There are great people in it. And then there are the people who will end up ruining your life.
Just the other day, I saw a girl running along the road that looked like she was about high school age. She was wearing a USMC t-shirt. And I thought that if she joins, then she's gonna have to accept rape and destruction of her life. I cannot, in good faith, I could not recommend anybody to join with the way the organization is set up now. I would not wish that on anyone.
You can't ask women to serve and then say, oh, by the way, if you get in one of these horrendous situations, we won't be there to back you up or to help you.
When I would do nominations for the Air Force Academy, you know, it was difficult to talk to parents and say, don't worry, if you send her here, she's not gonna get raped.
No, I would tell my daughter not to join the military. They have good things to offer, but a rape is not one of them.
Not in my lifetime. She's not joining now.
I would be terrified if my daughter wanted to join the military. I would have a serious long talk with her and hope that she'd, the one thing that's what she'd listen to.
Losing even one soldier needlessly because of military sexual trauma is one too many.
I'm going to get the mail. Fingers crossed. Here's my fate.
What does it say?
Effective October 20th, 2009. My overall combined rating is 70%. Wait. Service connection for anxiety is denied. Service connection for disc placement and bilateral disc displacement is denied. Those motherfuckers, man. Oh my God.
I'll be right there, Shay.
My face doesn't have any discs in it. That's what the x-rays show. That's what Dr. Carco's letters show.
How can you deny medical for, when there's x-rays?
We'll come get that.
What?
We'll come in. You want to watch guillotine? Mommy, you want to watch guillotine?
Uh-huh, we will.
If you do not agree with our decision, you should write us and tell us why.
Because you're an asshole.
And you should identify specific issues.
You're an idiot.
The evidence was reviewed showed that you served whatever, which is less than minimum active duty requirements for disability pension. But it wasn't your choice.
They're going to punish me for what they did. Because I was short. 2 months of 2 years.
Oh, my birth is not that thing.
I know. I feel the same way, Shay.
It's nice to see you again, and thank you for coming. You have been provided highlights of the numbers of the report, and I'll walk you through those slides, and then I'm going to play a short public service announcement, and then we can entertain questions.
I think the prevention aspect of sexual assault goes back in some ways to risk reduction.
What is risk reduction?
Risk reductions are ideas like telling women to, if they're going to go somewhere together, always have a buddy with them.
Are there other examples of risk reduction?
I'm not familiar, but that's out of my area of expertise.
Well, I want to continue where Dr. Whitley left off, looking at what our focus is, and that's on prevention as well as response. We've really done a very good job there, and the credit goes to Dr. Whitley and her staff that has been working this for the last 5 to 6 years.
I don't think the Department of Defense has really yet embraced that they have a sexual assault problem, that it's not just an issue of the culture or environment or that the people are at risk for sexual assault, that their system itself, though, just does not value the rights of victims and doesn't provide them adequate protection.
I have heard the accusations as well that, commanders are sweeping this under the carpet. Now, what I would say to the people that have come forward to you is, if you feel your commander is ignoring what you have asked them to do, if they're not taking care of you within that chain of command, you need to go to the DOD, the Department of Defense Inspector General.
GAO, General Accounting Office, just did a study, a report, and guess what? Not one case of more than 2,500 has been reviewed and investigated by the Inspector General. And when asked about that, the Inspector General said, well, we have other higher priorities.
What you really want is you want there to be a system akin to a civilian system where you go to the police and the crime is prosecuted by an impartial judicial system.
As a commander, you have no favorites. You are equally to take care of every single person in your organization. That's what command is all about.
These are human beings just like everybody else. You cannot be impartial when you are already involved with people in other settings.
I would take exception with your characterization that the disposition of the case is based on the relationship between the commander and the alleged perpetrator.
I'm going to speak to you with my former commander's hat on. There is absolutely no conflict of interest. You do what the right thing is to do. You have other avenues. And those, if you feel like you have not been taken care of adequately by your commander, go up through your congressman or your congresswoman, file a complaint that way.
You can't go to your congressman to obtain justice for being raped. I mean, imagine how silly that is. Imagine if you told civilians that. Oh, gee, sorry you were raped. Go talk to your congressman?
If you could say something to this guy, what would you want to say to him?
I don't know. I don't think it's affected his life at all. And people in my old squadron that I've talked to, they don't see any effect that it's had on him, and that hurts. Because it's a struggle every day. It's completely changed who I am.
I'm really hoping that he falls off a Coast Guard boat and they never find him. I'm really hoping for that. Like they find there's a poor mishap where he got chopped up by the prop.
That'd be great.
That would be great.
That'd be an exciting day.
It would. I'd probably celebrate.
Right?
Yeah.
I hope this reaches them too. You know, I hope that somewhere someone sees my face, you know, wherever it is and goes, I know them and they're talking about me because they know what they did, you know. And then all they'll have to mutter is to some friend that goes, hey, weren't we stationed with her? You know, and then they can't be a secret anymore. So hopefully they have to deal with it too, you know, some way, shape, or form.
Most rapists are repetitive criminals. It's a kind of crime that has an obsessive quality, so people do it again and again. So the tragedy of that is that every one of these guys who gets off free will be doing it to other women again and again, often for years and years and years.
The average sex offender in their lifetime has about 300 victims, and the vast majority of sex offenders will never be caught.
A lot of civilians see it as being a military problem, but it really isn't, because 5% or less of reported offenders are convicted. So almost none of them wind up on the sex offender registry.
There is no military sex offender list that I'm aware of, but if you're convicted in court, a felony conviction of a sex offense, you're gonna go on the national list.
For any sex offense whatsoever.
Correct.
That is not the case. It depends on what level of conviction they got. If they received over a year, then that's considered a felony. But a lot of these cases are pled down so that they're not felonies. The military doesn't like to prosecute people and keep them as felony convictions.
I often ask myself the question, why would they stop? And if there's nothing to stop them, like incarceration or some other major life change, they're gonna continue.
If you run a sexual predator through the judicial system and then you give them a slap on the hand, all you've done is you've done the equivalent of the catch and release program. You've caught him, you've educated him, and now you released him back into hometown America. He now knows a lot more about the law enforcement, the judicial system, than he did when he first started, which makes him a much more capable criminal and a much more dangerous criminal.
They go on to literally prey on women and men in our neighborhoods across the United States. I mean, if we don't care about women or men in the military, then we hopefully should care about women and men, you know, girls and boys in our neighborhoods back home.
The thing that broke my heart more than anything about this story was the young women who went in with such idealism. I want to serve my country, I want to give back. To see a young person's hope and idealism crushed in that brutal way, I think we owe our young people more than that.
Increasingly, women are becoming some of the best trained professionals that we have in the military. These are great soldiers, and we can't afford to lose them.
Yeah, I'm happy to never have to worry that again. People deeply believe in their hearts to serve their country. They should be given that chance, with respect. You know, it's part of, really, our American way.
Do you think that we deserve Purple Hearts because we were wounded in time of war?
They're never gonna give us one.
You know, but I'm just saying, maybe there should be a ribbon for women who...
who served our country.
Who have survived it, you know?
Survived it.
We have a good army, a good military, but not a great one. And this is the kind of issue that keeps our military from being great.
We can view this as a shared challenge. It's not just a woman's issue. It's not just something that the military has to deal with, but as a society, we're all in this together. It's our national duty.
From where you stand, there's no way to change it, no way to make it make sense. It is lonely there in the spotlight. Well, honey, don't I understand? You need someone to love you. You need someone to hold you. Tonight, someone Will you look at me and try hard to hide it, try hard to keep it all in? Well, I found you out, discovered your secrets. Well, honey, it ain't a sin that you need someone to love you. You need someone to tell. Everything is alright. Someone to love.